Welcome to the tribal.
Welcome.
That's okay. So welcome to the February 15th tri board meeting. So tonight we have a joint meeting starting at 6 o'clock with our school committee representatives, as well as our finance committee representation, and obviously the select board. So the items that we have on the agenda for discussion are the composition of the finance committee and moving forward, how the finance committee may be functioning in terms of integration with the budget process. Want to take an initial look at the town administrator's FY 2018 budget, talk about areas of within that budget that may require some further review, and also make sure that we're clear on what's not currently included in the budget. And then we need to establish a schedule to review the departmental budget requests in order to hit our deadlines. Okay. And then anything else that anybody else would like to talk about. So would it be okay if we start by talking about the finance committee?
Okay.
Hi, Amy. So David, do you have an update on where we stand right now in terms of the composition of the finance committee?
So right now we have two members that are active on the finance committee, Amy Fiden, who's with us tonight, and Valerie Hood, who can't be here tonight. Mm-hmm. We've had resignations from Mark Klopacki and from Terry Yushko, and there was a vacancy already. Mm-hmm. I talked to Brian West, the moderator, who appoints the finance committee. I invited him to this meeting. He may be here. And he had some prospects. Doesn't seem like those are working out so well. I did talk to Brian. I mentioned that the budget right now is balanced. That may change, but right now it's balanced. And that we're talking about a different approach for the finance committee to address the budget recommendation in time for the annual town meeting. Whereas formerly the finance committee met on Saturday mornings, starting at 8 o'clock in the morning, going on to at least noon, if not longer, week after week. In my mind, that was not a great way to ask volunteers to serve on a committee that was going to be chewing up half the weekend and going through minute detail on each and every single budget. There has to be a better way, and so we talked about some of the ideas that may be put forth, such as more of an overview of the budget rather than down in the weeds into the nitty-gritty details. Certainly if there's a question on a line item, we can talk about that, but we should be focusing in on more of is the budget request reasonable, and what does the department for that do that's supported by the budget? And you know, that should make things a little bit easier. Maybe meeting jointly with the select board in order to review major functions such as public works, public safety, education, human services, culture and recreation, general government, rather than going department by department. So get things done in fewer meetings on weeknights when people are not committed to family obligations, and focus in on the big picture rather than the details.
You think that would be helpful to your committee?
Oh, absolutely.
Well, okay. So, I mean, but in the past, you guys have kind of set that up where it's just been kind of the way it's always been done, so it was kind of a carryover. That's why it was continued.
Well, I think that it was good, especially for the first time. It was a lot of hours.
Sure.
But it was good to get the overview. Mm-hmm. But it's a big commitment. And once you do have the overview once, I don't think to do it every year would be necessary. We could do a lot as a joint to listen. Mm-hmm. Or, you know, even if you did it, watch it on TV, something like that. Mm-hmm. I think we should still keep up on what's happening with the departments. But I don't think to the extent of listening to every nitty-gritty, I mean, like David said,
mm-hmm. Over for versus minutia. Okay.
So when we get to the point where we're scheduling the, kind of looking at the calendar and scheduling out you know, feel free to chime in terms of what is going to work for you, because I think, you know, again, when I was on finance committee, it was that kind of complete separation. Finance committee really did their own thing and then just came in front of the select board once the select board was getting to their final deliberations on the budget.
With recommendations. And
with recommendations, sure. Yeah. And then a couple of years back, we tried that, when Dan Didkevitz was on the board, we tried that integrated approach where the finance committee and the select board together met with the department heads. And it sounds like you're saying maybe a hybrid, you know?
Yeah, well, I think that we could go back if we had more questions, you know, get the overview of what they're looking for, but then, and then later, I'm not saying the finance committee should still just get together and make their own opinion, mm-hmm. and then if we have additional questions, reach out to them. But as far as listening to, I don't think the boards, the department heads necessarily need to tell the whole thing twice either.
Right. That makes sense to me. Yeah, because again, you're asking for it's not redundant. Just the volunteers to do.
Well, it's just redundant unless something drastically changes.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like special ed and school choice and so on and so forth. I mean, those are the things that are forever changing.
Nothing it shouldn't be changing changes. In between the select board and the finance committee, though. It
no.
Should be. Yeah.
No. Mm-hmm. I'm just saying that those are things that need to be brought to our attention. You know, those type of things.
Yeah. And Amy, do you feel like you're getting good information and the best information that you need to function as a finance committee member?
I do.
Okay.
David is very helpful when we go over the numbers and explains where they come from, mm-hmm. you know, and what can we do and what we can't do in case we're not sure of what our regulations are.
Okay, good. So I think the big change then is really the schedule.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I think you make it volunteer friendly, but also financially effective.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Okay, so what makes up a good finance committee member while we're asking people this evening? It's the people with a financial background would be most helpful with budgeting.
So,
helpful but not required.
Yeah. I always look at the finance committee as the taxpayer's representative at the table while we're putting the budget together.
Yeah.
So people of the community who have an interest in the future of the community, have a long-term commitment to the community, and want to do the most responsible thing in terms of providing services that people need. They need their streets plowed. They need their children educated. They need the tax rate set. They need police and fire and ambulance, libraries, senior services, veteran services. The list goes on. Everybody needs those services.
Mm-hmm. I think it's also important that someone that really knows Hadley. Because I come from a financial background, but I thought was really useful is some of the people that really knew Hadley really well.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Knew the history. Yeah. History's always helpful. Yeah. So
they want to spend the buck.
Yeah.
I think the biggest thing is getting people that are willing to make a time commitment. You know, it's hard to get anybody to volunteer for any committees today. Mm-hmm. You know, and you get dragged over the coals and everybody's apprehensive to run for elected office today, and the finance committee is sort of a little independent and they can voice their own opinions, and it's a good place to start if you want to get involved in municipal government.
Mm-hmm.
We're by no means have a patent on that, though. In a lot of the local municipalities, you're seeing a lot of different things occur. I know in South Deerfield, the selectmen just voted on a $5,000 raise for themselves, so that there's more of a financial commitment if we're based on hours. So, I mean, I'd rather people volunteer, but we may need to stop tending and drop back and punt on this and try to understand what we need to do to stimulate to get as much help as we can. And it's not necessarily just for any particular finance committee or anything else, but to make sure that there's an effort to help people volunteer, I guess, for any of the boards. I know the school committees has two vacancies that they're looking to fill this year in the election. I don't know how many of the papers have been taken out like that, but it doesn't seem like civics is on top of everybody's list anymore. And whatever we can do to make that work just makes everything better for everybody.
Yeah, and I think one thing, I'm just going to throw this out there because I heard, certainly, you know, in talking to people who finance committees, past members and people who thought about it but said no, ultimately, Another area that seems to be of a concern to people is, you know, when people put themselves out there and they volunteer, they also want to be treated respectfully. And Donald just mentioned, you know, trying to get people to run for elected office. I mean, it's not always the most pleasant experience, and people don't always agree with you, and they don't necessarily, you know, people have differing viewpoints. But I think we all need to collectively remind each other that people are coming to the table intending to do the best they can, given the task at hand. They're not there to, you know, purposely, you know, give you a headache or whatever just because they disagree. But I think in meetings we need to stop getting used to sometimes letting people treat other people badly and just, you know, collectively stopping it and say that's not the way we're doing it here. And I think I was actually a little bit surprised. I heard that from more than one person and thought, yeah, that's a good point. So
I also think, too, that you don't run for an office, whether I was on school committee or the select board, you don't run for an office for your own agenda. You run because of you care about the education of the children of Hadley, and there certainly is enough children in town where the younger ones, you're going to be in the school system for a long time, and this is a time for when they should be trying to get involved and start out on the ground and seeing it through until your child graduates from high school to make sure they do have that best education. Same thing with the finance committee. It's supposed to be a team effort of all of us working together, and it's taken us a good deal of time to come and get to this point of where the boards and townspeople are all trying to now work together, whether it's the police and fire or the schools or senior center. I mean, it's all so worthwhile, and you know, you have, look at the seniors that are still volunteering, you know, and they're getting things done because that's what it takes to do, is that people put in the time. Yep. So I'm asking people to come out and, you know, volunteer for some of these things, and I'm putting in a plug.
It would be a kinder, gentler experience.
Kumbaya.
Yeah, I think now's the time to, you know, get involved in your child's life through all their years. And same thing with being on the finance committee and helping out here. Again, it's nice if you have a financial background and know the numbers and can do some calculating, but there certainly is enough support help here in town hall and throughout the departments that are willing to help you. So I said, would love to have people come out.
You know, it's not a unique situation for Hadley. This is going on everywhere in the Commonwealth where people aren't volunteering. The volunteerism is a big asset for the town, because if you have to instill consultants, the value of cost to get it accomplished, you know, we've had two buildings coming in, the senior center and the sub-fire station, and we've got a multitude of volunteers for that. We're saving hundreds of thousands of dollars by those volunteers putting forth their time, you know, and I don't know what we can do to entice more people to come out. It's a tough situation.
One of the things I think we can do is we can also point out that this is an opportunity to not only an opportunity to serve, but also an opportunity to develop skill sets that you may be looking to develop, but may not have the opportunity to do so. I'm thinking particularly of younger people who are looking to add something to a resume, who also want to be involved in work that we're at a relatively young age. You can have major impacts by your decisions on a community. This is an opportunity for us to grow the next generation, if you will.
Yeah. Do you have anything to add that you'd like to?
Let's appeal to the women and men that marched in Northampton and Greenfield and Boston and Washington, D.C., and wonder what they can do next. One thing they can do is get involved locally.
That's right. Start with something that you can control and see an immediate impact on.
If you were unhappy with the direction of our country, make a change.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so with that said, then, again, we're looking for additional members of the to help on the Finance Committee. Anybody who's interested can contact either our town moderator directly, Brian West. They can contact one of the sitting Finance Committee members, Amy Fiden or Valerie Hood, or they can certainly contact Jennifer James at the select board office, and any one of us as well. But, you know, please reach out if you have questions and you just want to talk about it. We're happy to talk through what is actually involved. Okay?
Thank you.
All right. So do we want to go on to an overview of the budget first before we get into the scheduling?
Sure. What would be most helpful? Last time I gave a brief presentation of the goals and objectives.
Before David starts, can I make
sure.
a comment?
Yeah.
And I really want to know if an override is on the table or off the table, because we have to finalize our warrant at the end of the night, and if it's a possibility, after all the discussion we have this evening, maybe we could talk amongst all of us to see if it could be put in as a warrant article. If we don't use it, that's well and fine. We could always pass over it or pull it, but I think we should consider a possibility.
As members of the select board, Donald, we can open the warrant down the road as well.
Mm-hmm.
I would certainly love to talk about that, and I would love to have a discussion, but I'd like to do it after we understood the shortcomings that we have here and what the shortcomings are and what the cost would be, and then what we can, you know, when we got a better idea of what the budget looks like, I think it'd be better for us to talk about it then. But as far as if you wanted to open it up and put one on as a placeholder, I'm supportive of that idea.
Yeah, we don't have to use it.
Exactly.
But, you know, I think it's an option that we have to keep open. And I think we'll learn more after we talk to the school and see what their situation is. I know our situation with the fire department and their staffing, we're definitely going to need more revenues mm-hmm. to afford what we want to do as a community. And if that's an alternative, it's a possibility. So, yeah.
So has everybody on the select board had the opportunity to go through the budget?
I've perused it, but I haven't got into the...
Okay. Are there any, Jen, you have, yeah.
Right, yeah.
Were there any changes? Because I know the school line item actually was a question.
Let's talk a little bit, if we can, then, about the maintenance on the buildings, maintenance, where that money's coming from, and what line item is that, David?
That'll be budget 490, and give me a second, I'll come up with the page number for that.
The buildings committee, I know,
was looking up the page number. I sent David, and I think only David, an email today saying I thought the budget book was really informative and well organized. So let me compliment him while on camera.
May I add that I think this budget book looks like it's on its way to GFOA, Distinguished Budget Award?
See?
I feel like somebody might be submitting.
Say, not that David had that on his mind at all.
Of mine's in the car. It's not a great place for it.
Oh, you can be in chair.
Yeah, so...
Do you have an extra one?
No, I can share.
I can share.
Keep it.
She has good eyes.
So, I'm sorry. So we're not talking about the schools.
So
we're going
you.
To maintenance?
You're
if we, you asked if we had any questions.
So on page 65 is budget 490.
Mm-hmm.
And I had some description about it earlier, so let me make sure that I'm conversing with that.
Welcome to my book.
Okay, so let me make sure that I have this correct. Pardon me while I... And also on page 19 and 20, there's a little description of what I did. But basically, there's been a discussion about increasing the building maintenance budget in general, but also a consolidation of items from other disparate budgets into one central maintenance, which would be under the direction of the Department of Public Works. So all the custodial services I brought into one budget, the alarm systems, the elevator contracts, the general groundskeeping, and some of the maintenance supplies. I pulled that all together. Basically, it's an increase of, it's a transfer, I should say, a net zero transfer of $46,250. taken out of other budgets and put into 490. In addition, I increased the overall budget by about $20,000 in order to provide additional capacity to perform the general and routine maintenance on all the buildings. That budget increase between the transfers and the increases basically it doubled, went from $61,500 to $127,700 for FY18.
But the transfers is no additional money into a budget. That's money that has been taken out of a one budget that has now been put into here, and it's right. just under a central location. Right. That truly is not an increase in the right. in the.
Well, I did both. There was the transfers, which are net zero, but I also increased the budget, the base budget, by $20,000.
Okay.
In addition, there are two articles that remain available for expenditure, which have a total of $140,000, which can be used for building maintenance.
And they are what?
That's two articles that are... Let me see
if I... If we can redirect that when we go through the warrants later, that would be fine with me, as long as I can remember that.
So we have next Tuesday. $27,000 for building maintenance. Some of that is a transfer.
So last year we had 66, right?
61.
61 last year. So we're actually going from 61 to 81 with a 46 transfer.
Right.
Okay. Of the 46 that we're transferring over, was all that money used last year from those budgets?
Last year, yes.
Okay, so that's not a net increase at all?
No.
Okay. So the net increase that we're looking at is $20,000?
That's correct.
Okay.
Has there been any conversation with the Municipal Building Committee?
Yes, I showed them an earlier draft of this with higher numbers.
But much higher numbers than this.
Right, but as we got further into the budget, and recognizing that they have $147,000, which is not in the budget but is available to them, and trying to help other departments out, towards the end, I made the reductions.
Okay, so that's definitely a group. I mean, we knew it anyway, but we're going to want to talk through that with them to find out what, you know, harm there may be. In that type of a reduction, but I understand what you did given the fact that there's still 147 sitting there to be deployed. You good with that?
I can explain it now.
Yep, okay. So this, could we just jump to the school line item? So has there been any change since information was provided to David? So we went to the school committee meeting and you talked about what wasn't included in your budget. And I think, David, you took kind of the middle figure.
Right, so I'm trying to grab that budget very quickly here.
Level funded.
Well, there are two, here we go. There are two budgets that are being offered by the school. One is an increase for level services, and then there's an additional expanded services.
Page you're on, David.
Eighty-eight.
So the expanded services are $112,000 above the request. The request was $7,150,530. I squeezed everything as much as I could, but I still have a gap of $216,363. So I'm asking that that amount come out of the school choice, which I know is something we haven't talked about. So obviously that's a full meeting right there.
Comment, reaction.
Well, in response to the first question you had asked, has anything changed since you were at the school committee meeting in January? And nothing definitive. The same moving parts are the same moving parts. We haven't yet locked in on oil. We expect to do that soon. We don't have all of our vocational and technical applications in yet, and we still may have some potential cost-saving measures in special education, but again, I couldn't commit to those at this point. Is it, in some cases, an entire team of people have to agree before we go into that. So same things are still at play, and when they're definite, we'll certainly make adjustments, and my goal is that those adjustments are good for the total bottom line for the town.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. For Jerry and Joyce, you weren't at our school committee meeting.
Mm-hmm.
The lines that are increasing is Smith Vote and Special Ed.
If, see that.
If you look at those lines that we have discretion over,
mm-hmm.
we have a 1% increase to the budget. We are legally obligated to provide vocational education and special education, and those are the areas that are increasing
mm-hmm.
that we don't have any control over. That said, Annie has applied for funding to look into greater collaboration with Grandy, have submitted a regionalization and efficiency grant, thanks to the MMA conference and the text I sent during the conversation with the Lieutenant Governor. What else are we looking at?
So we're looking, there are a number of things, some of them larger, some of them smaller. So one is the grant, another is the development of a program with two other neighboring districts that has the potential to result in actual cost savings in special education. This would be a program for students who are currently in programs outside of the district. And that's a potential for cost savings. As I said at the school committee meeting, what happens when you reduce your expenses, in that case, you also drive down the revenues you get back in terms of circuit breaker. So that's the other reason why all these parts are moving parts. And we are in negotiation right now to share food SIP services with Gateway Regional School District. That will give us some savings in town. We already share behavioral services with Grandy, and I'm trying to think of what other services we share. I feel like I'm missing one right now, but we're actively pursuing every avenue we can to share services in the school department with other towns, and we've brought a lot of that to fruition.
Great. Thank you.
We have more students going to Smith, or the increase on the tuition?
Not on the tuition this year. On the tuition, we'll see. They say that they want to keep their tuition at the same level as last year, although technically I believe that according to the formula, it should actually be about $500 less per student. We'll see what the commissioner decides. I think it should be. Last year it was supposed to be $500 less per student, and the commissioner granted them kind of a hardship exception for their tuition. And this year we have just a spike in students who are interested. That happens sometimes from class to class. So we had about 11 students express an interest, and each student is $17,000. Our transportation line to Smith is another $18,000, not per student total.
You're still and sharing that with Amherst?
If yes, we do share that with Amherst. That's another place we have a transportation shared contract with Amherst. Thank you, Joyce.
Mm-hmm.
If a student has an individual education plan, there's an additional surcharge. So the minimum, if you do that in your head, that 11 students, you're already close
18.5.
To just, yeah.
You're 18.5 a student.
Yeah,
with transportation.
Right, and then if you may have a special ed surcharge on that.
Okay.
And so times 11, that's a potential big increase for next year.
Yeah.
And we had two unexpected expenses in the special education line.
Is the 18.5, is that a reasonable number for other Volk schools? I mean, I love Smith Volk, but is that a number that's a decent number?
So what happens in terms of out-of-district tuition rates, the out-of-district tuition rates, it is pretty comparable, and anybody can look at those in the Department of Elementary and Secondary Education's website under Career and Technical Education. They post the rates because the department has to approve. So a non-resident tuition, even though we've historically always used Smith, it's not a regional vocational school, so everybody pays non-resident tuition except for probably Northampton, I'm imagining, but everybody else does. So that rate is not outrageous. So
We have been approached by Pathfinder Regional School District to explore becoming a member of Pathfinder. What happens in a regional district, when you're part of a regional district for vocational education, is you do become eligible for transportation, a portion of your transportation costs to be reimbursed. That isn't the most expensive, as I said. Right now we're paying 18. That's not really what's...
Doesn't seem unreasonable.
That's really not where the expenses are.
And the time to get there, and, you know. And do they offer more opportunities for different skills at Pathfinder?
I couldn't fairly answer. I don't have in my head the list of their Chapter 74 programs vis-a-vis Smith's programs. The other thing that happens with regional vocational, when you're a member, sometimes this is good, sometimes it's bad, is they do something called a pro rata model. So it's proportionate share, and how much you pay of the budget is tied to your percentage of enrollment very often. And that is, you would think, Hadley's a small place, it's probably great, but what can happen is if one of the other players has an unexpected drop off in enrollment, you can get a really big surprise. We used the same tuition model at the collaborative when I was there. And I can tell you, I did have some districts would say, what happened this year? There was no change in enrollment, and their tuitions went way up because somebody else had a decline. So it's vocational and technical education is, it's a wonderful thing. Children who are interested deserve it. They should pursue that. And it's their federal right. And it's also very expensive to deliver. So it's really, it's just hard to get around. It's very expensive to deliver it.
What about total enrollment in the schools?
Yeah, it is. We've seen a decline, not a precipitous decline. And I don't want to put Roby on the spot, but certainly regionally, I know that she's attended a lot of conversations about this at CES.
It's like, what do you do?
So she could speak to, this is something that everyone is facing. Yep. So we're down. Now, we have seen a decline. Our kindergarten cohorts are... continue to go down, but we're not unusual. Like we're not losing more children to choice than we're gaining. Just throughout this entire region, there just aren't enough children. I'd like to encourage our viewers to just have a lot
have
of children.
Yeah.
Live in Hadley. That's it. Just one thing. That's all I ask.
And have a child.
Some of them aren't even having
them. Could we take a minute and explain to the citizens in Hadley about school choice? A lot of them have envisioned in their mind that we still have $1.5 million in there, you know, at the highest point. Mm-hmm. And it's been depleted a great deal, and what it's certified at now. And I know you came to our other meeting, the tri-board meeting, and we sat at your budget hearing, and we know that it's coming down. It's not replenishing itself as it did in the past. And I think the people in town should know basically how it works and where we're at today.
Sure. So we had a balance. I don't know if I want to use the word certified. I guess perhaps it wasn't the town side, but from the town, we had a balance on July 1st of this year, so fiscal year 17, of just about $714,000. And we applied in our budget, in our original budget, we applied about $500,000 of school choice, and I'm saying about because we'll end up, just because we had unanticipated expenses this year, that we were hit with $186,000 of special education expenses that weren't anticipated, we'll end up using more school choice. We expect this year roughly a projected revenue of about $445,000. So right there, people might be saying, well, look at them, they're over $1 million. Again, that hasn't taken out. Actually, we expect to perhaps use as much as $680,000 in fiscal year 17. Our 17 revenue is down from our 16 revenue. We had roughly, I think, 18 students graduate in June who were all school choice students. We anticipate another 12 of this class, 12 graduates are school choice students. And so we might only end up seeing around $400,000 in school choice next year. Some people might say, well, why can't you just say exactly how much you're going to get? Because if a student has an individual education plan, we get something called the special education increment. So it could be, it's for a student who just comes in, we bill the Sandy District $5,000. For a student with special education expenses, We bill back the district for those expenses, and that shows up on the school choice revenue. So again, it sounds like 714 to start, you're getting in 450, that seems like a lot of money. We are looking at applying as much as $680,000 in this fiscal year. We had thought that we would apply around 435 to the budget next year, in fiscal year 18. But again, based on town constraints and other things, we will most likely have to relook at that number. That's a conversation for the school committee. I don't drive that conversation. So it's easy to see if somebody just went into town and said, tell me exactly what the school choice balance is today. We're not applying those school choice revenues monthly toward the school department budget. We apply it at the end of the year. And so it gets high and then it gets wiped out. And there was a time, I do believe, that the school choice fund was, I mean, I've spoken directly with the previous superintendent, and I think it was well over $1 million. And it is now, you know, we're really trying hard to keep it at $500,000, I think is the school committee's desire, which still is not 10%. As there was a conversation here at the select board of 10% being a number that auditors feel good about in terms of percentage of operating budget to have in fund balance or reserves. So that doesn't represent 10% of operating budget, but they're still trying, I don't want to speak for them, to keep it at a healthy place. That's a struggle.
We've been overspending. We're spending more than we're taking in, and we have for the last couple of years to make up the lack of revenues.
We've been doing the same thing on the municipal side, so don't feel bad. You know, it's the same thing we're all doing.
But also because there's a point at the time when it's not going to be there anymore.
That's the point I wanted to bring out in the discussion about our override. So we start getting this information from you people at school that $260,000 is a very significant hit. You know, people don't realize, you know, they think you've got an abundance of money. So that's part of the discussion I think Jerry wants to hear too, and it's coming out, and we can get the numbers on our sides for the municipal government, but we need to have the numbers from you people when we formulate all this up together in the end to come up with a figure, maybe. So
using the figure that David has put in the budget, which, as he indicated, was a $200,000 reduction from the ask. So that, theoretically, all other things being equal and barring any unforeseen movement on the spend cost and further movement in either direction, that would then draw your school choice reserve
down to 285.
Yeah.
I mean, and that's hard to say again, because as I pointed out, those who comes in could change, those revenues could change, and the special education increment could change because school choice is blind. But it could very well.
Or we would decide to make cuts, because that
is too low.
That puts the school choice account really too low. Mm-hmm. I mean, there would then be potentially draconian cuts the next year.
We're just going to say you'd be,
because we build.
You know how people used to look at the school choice account as being part of educating that child that came from the out of district. Mm-hmm. They don't understand that it's incorporated into the overall part of the budget, and they just think that, well, that's what it's there for. You should just spend it as it is, but that's not, wasn't totally what the purpose of it is.
Yeah.
So I think they had a misconception of.
Well, and I think to Donald's earlier point, because we usually apply the school choice at the end of the year, there is a point that it's really a pretty high balance, and we're not using it until like May. And one thing we've talked to the business manager about is use it quarterly or biannually, so that balance never reaches that number, that then there's this moment in time that if someone sees that, says, hey, the schools have $1 million,
mm-hmm.
when we've budgeted to use 686,000 of it, and it just isn't moved out yet.
And the other point to make, too, is that to the extent the reserve is drawn down significantly to kind of a bare-bones figure, then the reality is, if, you know, you have X number of sped placements or unexpected expenditures, you're just going to be coming right back here anyway. So this is a way to kind of self-contain.
Right. Because it would, exactly, that would have to, that the town, that responsibility, I pointed this out at the school committee meeting, that the obligation, particularly with special education, is I'm designated, I'm the town's designee for you to fulfill that obligation, but it's a town obligation. It's not even in law listed as a school department obligation. It's the town of Hadley's obligation for child find, to ensure that every child with special needs is found and served in your town, whether they go to Hadley Public Schools or not, we do that. If they go to private school, we go and look for them and offer services.
You have to do homeschool kids if they have special needs.
That's correct.
You know, and you have to offer them the OT or PT or speech or reading or whatever they might need for extra, and it just might not be within the school system, but they're still within the district.
And so, to your point, we would just end up, the town would have to fulfill that obligation, so we couldn't say, well, you don't have the money for it. The town would have to fulfill the obligation.
After recalling the last tri-board meeting when you were here in your school board budget hearing, ideally, I get out of it.
What's the hearing? Our hearing's not until March.
No, but, you know, just discussion of the budget itself I'm referring to. But ideally, it seems like around 700,000 is the level you would like to be at in school choice and not go below that, right?
If the school committee were to apply the 10% as the
rule,
then.
And that's where it comes out around. That's what you spoke about.
$7 million budget?
Yeah, the other being, that's where you come up with the 700,000, okay.
How about the burden for Chapter 70 monies? I mean, I sit here and I look at it, and I know that, you know, numbers are big for everybody, and you stop and look at it, and between the request on the 18 budget and the actual on the 15 budget, the difference is 18.3% over the three-year period. So we're talking about 6.1% every year that the budget's going up. Has the state gone up 6.1% in their burden on this getting done?
No.
And if this is unfunded mandates and it's things that are not going to go away anyways, I mean, I'm back to where Donald's talking about this, and it's swimming upstream. I mean, it's a 6%, a 6%, and a 6% increase that the community is absorbing, that you guys are doing a good job at keeping it as low as you can, but it's still, it's a monumental number when we compare it to the budget for the municipality. What can we do about that? Can we, first of all, tell me about the Chapter 70 monies over just the last 3 years that we're talking about here. How has that money gone up?
So David may be able to help me speak to the exact amount that we got here, but it would have been negligible. I want to say certainly under $100,000 increase. It was probably closer, well, perhaps David, do you
have that? Is it on the assessments line item?
Yeah. The increase? The challenge with the Chapter 70 funding, Chapter 70 formula, and there's an entire review committee to look at Chapter 70, and this is a rather boring repeat for the school committee because they heard it already, but I think it's helpful to the public. So we are reliant on a formula. Chapter 70 is the money that goes to the municipality that assists with the schools, and that formula assumes certain things. One thing that formula assumes is that your students who are special education in district, it limits those students to 4.75% of total enrollment. So in the Chapter 70 funding formula for FY18, it assumes 21 students in district are receiving special services, receiving special education. That's about a quarter of the actual students receiving special education. They have a cap on how many students of your total population they count as going out of district. So that percentage is closer to just over 1%. So they put a cap of 5 students going out of district, and there are more than 5 students going out of district. And they put a cap on vocational students at 4.75 of total enrollment, and that cap is 23 students, and we potentially could have 34 students going to vocational next year. They assume the cost of educating a student who's qualified for a vocational, a voc tech student, they assume that cost to be roughly $13,382, and as you pointed out,
roughly,
it's closer to $18,500, and that assumes the student isn't receiving special education services. They assume that the cost for out-of-district placements are $37,000 in the formula, and on average, that is closer to $57,000. So
that's
not
in
only
Hadley. Is that everywhere?
That's everywhere.
This is everywhere. This isn't Hadley's numbers that we're talking about.
These are Hadley's numbers for the community funding characteristics that matter also.
So Hadley doesn't get as much as districts that have poorer populations.
But the formula that was generated is generated on a mass average.
It was generated a long time ago, and it was a result of years of compromises.
Yes.
And,
long time ago.
Yeah. And but everybody knows it's
reform.
Outmoded, but they
it
don't
was
want to fix
reform.
It.
So,
but it doesn't, just so you know, that formula, the percentage caps and those things apply to all towns. So the numbers, the percentage caps apply to all towns. But what those numbers translate into would depend on the size of your district.
So for the governor's proposal for Chapter 70, it's an $11,200 increase over last year. That's about a 1% increase in the Chapter 70 account, which hardly keeps pace at all.
Does not keep
That's
pace.
Not even one child going
yeah.
to vocational education.
But the municipality had a difference in discretionary monies.
I'm not following.
Didn't you tell me that the municipality had a difference in discretionary monies that could be spent as the town saw fit, that didn't fall into 70s?
There is some additional money coming in from what's called unrestricted general government aid. That went up by $17,000 under the governor's proposal.
Okay. Okay. Sorry.
It's a drop in the bucket.
That's almost one kid, though.
Yeah.
You know, just one little segment. I was astonished reading this in the paper about Granby and your school lunch program. There were $148,000 in the hole. I couldn't believe it. And I think we're in a negative aspect. What, around 13, I think, or something? Which is minimal, really. Our school populations are fairly similar, I think. But to be in a hole that much, you know, is astonishing to me.
That has to be a cumulative over more than 1 year.
Yeah.
It has to be over more than 1 year.
Yeah,
but,
some expensive lunches.
You know.
So would it be...
I'm going there for lunch.
Since we're focused on the schools right now, would it be a good opportunity to talk about what's not included in the budget? Because that was one of the things we wanted to collectively understand about this overall budget, too.
We had impassioned parents appear at our last school committee meeting asking for another teacher in the elementary school. Mm-hmm. And they made a pretty convincing case that was backed up by all the administrators present.
What grade?
Grade 3.
Third grade?
Current
for,
grade.
For
fourth
going
grade next
fourth
year.
Grade.
And how many kids going into that?
Almost 50. So right now I think it's 48, I want to say.
With mm-hmm. many needs.
And you have a decreased enrollment in kindergarten? You still have just the two kindergarten classes?
Yeah, every other grade is that. No, not every other grade, because next year's sixth grade. We currently have three fifth grades. And we have just over 50 students in grade 5, which will be grade 6 next year. And right now, all of the grades have two classrooms. These parents are asking that we have three fourth grade classrooms.
Yeah,
in grade 2 now, do we presently have three classes?
Not in
right
two.
Now?
Not two.
No.
No, so you're handling it with two, and they want
three. Yeah. Their plea was that it wasn't really being handled because of the numbers. And
yeah,
that was
interesting, that meeting. Yeah. Mm-hmm. They were very vocal in it.
Yeah.
Is there a capping on that now with, as there used to be, like 20 to 22 per
19,
classroom?
19, wasn't it?
19.
No, we have suggestions for the lower grades, but not so much once they get past first
one,
grade.
Right.
Yeah, it's K-1.
We try to keep K-1 smaller class sizes.
Although it's my understanding, certainly Linda and Robbie can correct me, that typically when a grade gets over 50, at 50 or more, that is that not bringing?
We used to have that.
No, so maybe it goes
not,
further
not throughout
back.
The course.
Okay.
I don't think it's hard
been 15 years.
No,
so
it used
to
no
be
it's been dependent on the grade's characteristics.
Okay.
Yeah.
So we tried to submit a level services budget. We have this, as Roby pointed out, we had a petition and many parents come in asking for an expansion. For one grade.
Yeah. Okay. So I think it's fair to say then takeaways that the school line item, as it's currently funded, it should be an area of concern and an area to watch between now and finalizing the budget. So I'm just watching the clock. Go ahead, Amy.
And then I just have a quick question about adding
So if grade five, once they go to Hopkins, and so now you have an extra, what would you do with the grade three that has been moving up, and now they have an extra, so now you're one ahead?
You would do, if you didn't have additional students coming in, mm-hmm. then it would trigger reduction in force. And all the union collective bargaining agreements have reduction in force language about how we do that, and what seniority dictates about how qualified people bump other people.
There's no choice kids in that class, obviously.
That class has been closed. We haven't opened that class to choice. Not this year.
Okay, so we've got just over 10 minutes to get through the rest of the agenda. So in terms of the budget, one thing I thought might be helpful would be for David to just actually recap, was again kind of to make sure everybody's using the same language and understanding. David, you presented a balanced budget in accordance with the free cash policy that we collectively agreed to. Mm-hmm. Can you just, I know a couple of people have stopped me that were confused about the use of free cash, the way it's laid out.
Okay. So the select board did adopt a free cash policy. We had been using free cash in order to balance the budget. The select board decided that we'd like to move away from that practice and decided to approach that target of zero free cash used on recurring operating expenses to zero over a multi-year period. The select board asked that we reduce our reliance upon free cash by $75,000 per year until we reach that use of zero. Last year, we used $157,000 of free cash for recurring operating expenses within the omnibus budget. So we thought that we'd be able to achieve this in a two-year period. In order to help the schools out as much as I could, I didn't quite get to that $75,000 reduction. In this budget proposal, I achieved $64,000, about an $11,000 shortfall, but left a balance, a projected balance of $75,000 of free cash to be used for other purposes. So on page 22, you'll see the free cash spending plan. Estimating free cash to be $500,000 to be certified in the fall. That's a conservative figure, a safe figure to use. Using free cash for one-time expenses within the omnibus budget. So the first use is $257,000 for the transfer into the OPEB trust, which is a non-recurring cost. It's an installment on a total cost. Using $50,000 of free cash for the reserve fund controlled by the Finance Committee. We have an unfunded liability within the pension system associated with an early retirement from 2002 or 2003. That's $19,000. And then trying to add to the stabilization fund, as we had talked about, by a transfer of $5,000. Total $331,445 of free cash for...
All right. We can discuss it later.
Yeah, of course, everything's on the table.
Yeah.
That's non-recurring expenses that are funded through the omnibus budget. Then using $93,000 in order to achieve the balanced budget, leaving a free cash reserve for future use of $75,555.
Okay, so is everybody clear on that? Just when we're talking about the use of free cash, and
that I'm clear on that. I'm not clear on why you're putting money into the stabilization account.
We had talked about it. We haven't contributed to the stabilization except for interest for a long time. We also took money out of stabilization.
We're still over $2 million.
We're over $2 million, $2.1 million.
That's fine.
But
I can find someplace else for that $5,000.
If you remember correctly, we took $39,000 out of stabilization in order to fund, it was either $39,000 or $36,000 to fund the retro pay for the union contracts.
Mm-hmm.
So, and we promised at that time that we would repay that money.
I did not promise that. No.
It will be a future discussion point, I think it's safe to say.
Yes.
Roll the tape.
So the other thing, David, is on page 37, which is just a summary of expenses. You have a column labeled administrative add/deletions. So that column represents adjustments that you made to the departmental requests, correct?
That's correct.
Or if you theoretically could have added money in too. Have all of the departments been notified of any adjustments that are included in here?
I've circulated this with all the departments electronically so that everybody now has a copy of this.
So they know what we're seeing?
Yeah.
Okay. And then the other thing we talked about is, you know, there were things that we had indicated were a priority to the select board. We talked about continuing to take a look at public safety, particularly looking forward in terms of how to enhance fire service to our businesses and residents. And we had also talked about some significant needs here at Town Hall, just in terms of human resources and information technology.
All right, so we talked about adding four positions to the fire department. That's an additional $217,000 that we would have to raise in order to accomplish that. We talked about taking into account the implementation of the Department of Revenue recommendations in the Community Compact, and we have the report on the table right there. Specifically, they recommended that we develop an IT department, we develop a human resources position, and we combine the offices of treasurer and collector. They also made other recommendations, mm-hmm. which don't involve budget, but involve work. Mm-hmm. Then we also talked about a finance director position, which we're currently exploring the feasibility of sharing that position with another town.
Okay, and dollars associated with anything you just talked about is not included in?
That's correct,
right.
But it is notated.
Okay. Is there anything else that anybody was expecting to see in here that they're not seeing, or? No?
Nope.
Okay. Okay, so in the spirit of we have work to do, do we want to talk about a schedule then on how we're going to go through all of this?
So I recommend that you take it by major divisions within the budget. You've got the 100 series budget, which can meets all of Town Hall. Mm-hmm. 200 level services, which is public safety. 300 is education. 400 is Department of Public Works. 500 is human services. 600 would be culture and recreation. And then there's 700, 800, and 900, which are the debt, the assessments from the state, and the benefits.
Okay. The other thing, you know, that I think needs to be on the table while we're going through these departments, and I'm not sure how best to go about it, but I think that while we're focused on some of these functional areas, we really need to be talking about an ongoing drive towards efficiency and doing a better job at cost-benefit analysis. So I know something that we've talked about in the past, there are a couple of things. One is accountability and having better tracking on not only what's being done, but also what's not being done. We talked about that in prior years in the context of fire inspection services and building inspection services, you know, having a good handle on where we're at in the course of the year. And we don't have, you know, very good technology, quite frankly, to help track a lot of those things. And sometimes in the budget process, we get so focused on how much something costs dollar-wise, we forget what it's costing time-wise. Or again, you know, potential safety issues that are left on the table. And, you know, management, we've talked about town hall, and we have somewhat silos where we have people working on a part-time basis assisting one department, and then another part of their time they're assisting a different department, and trying to figure out a better way to manage those resources. So maybe you could be thinking about that, but I'd like to have those conversations while we're going through this budget process.
So what's the timeline on these meetings and doing the 100, 200s, 300s? Where are we going with that?
You said that you'd be signing the warrant on April 12th.
Right.
Okay.
So it's pretty much every meeting, I would think, is
doing
something on the budget from here on out. So what are we scheduled right now? We've got March 1st?
March 1st. Ash
Wednesday. So we have two in March?
So I'd throw that in.
There's five Wednesdays in March.
There are five Wednesdays in March?
Two in March.
Hooray.
And, right now, we have two in March and two in April.
Okay. Can we up it to three in March for sure?
Would it be in our best interest just to schedule a separate evening to deal with the budget?
Well, I don't think we can get everybody in one night. Even if we have one blockbuster 3-hour meeting. I think you're right. I mean, I think we need to carve out, like,
so much linked to this meeting, you know, our regular meeting.
Yeah.
When we do that. So that's, I was trying to segregate it out somehow little bit.
Yeah.
Unless we start at 6 o'clock instead of 7 and gain an hour there and have some people come in again. I don't know. I have no idea what's the easiest way to do it at this point.
Well,
we need three meetings in March. I mean, that's a given.
That's a given, yeah.
And in the past, if we've had to have an extra meeting, then so be it. This is budget time.
Yeah, it's budget time.
Know, and if we have to have an extra meeting that month, then we have another meeting that month and get it done.
Yeah. David, right now, based on what you think you know, is there any
major
Wednesday
change
in March that you cannot participate?
Every Wednesday in March I'm available for the board.
Okay, so you don't...
So aren't I, Molly?
He has other
No, I know that. But I'm just saying, if we need to do it and get it done, then just let's do it.
Okay. So for starters, do we want to add March 8th?
I do.
Okay.
I do too, Jerry.
That's all. The earlier the better.
That's
the better.
That's what I'm thinking. Yeah. So let's
agree too.
Yeah.
And then the more we can get done, then we can potentially reward ourselves with an evening off. So right now we have March 1st, 8th, and 15th scheduled.
Sounds good.
Okay. So for those three meetings, can we commit to
budget
getting all of these at least one fair hearing with everybody? Mm-hmm. I think that should work. Three.
Can you tell me which ones are to go with each one?
How far out do you want to go before you come back?
I don't know.
Well, I mean, would it help you to be not first on the agenda?
No, I think you should
third week.
The longer the better for the schools.
So things can settle out.
Oh, yeah.
So I think the Ides of March would be an excellent target for the schools.
Yeah, that was my dad's birthday. That was a good one.
David, Amy was just asking about scheduling, like which groups get scheduled when. Do you need to coordinate that with the department heads to see who's available on which evenings? Or are you prepared to take a stab at it now?
I should coordinate with them, but...
Just have a dispensation.
Do you have a preference?
No.
I think it would be good to get public safety up front. Because I think that there are some...
He's ready to roll.
This is shameless. Shameless. Right.
Okay.
Right. That'd probably be good.
What?
Okay.
Want to go first? Will Mike be ready?
Well,
so just
he's
let David work on that. Let's
I know.
Move along.
I'm just
asking. He's close.
Okay, so everybody comfortable with that? So that's the starting point. So I'll budget all the time in March. So, okay, anything
we'll
else for the tri-board?
I think we'll forego tri-board, too, because we'll be doing enough.
Right.
Do we, right?
Well, and then to Donald's point, we'll decide if it's going to be a 6 o'clock starter or not on those meetings. 6:30,
split it in the middle.
6:30?
6:30 sounds better to me, too.
That gives you more breathing room to get here. Are you okay with that,
Thank
Amy?
You.
Yeah.
Okay.
Spring is around the corner, everyone.
Yep.
And hopefully people will come out to sign up for these committees.
We'll have to bust that up. There's a continuation of a public hearing at 7:15, but we can work around that. That's for the poll location.
Okay. All right, we can.
We love polls.
All right, so.
Thanks so much.
Yeah, everybody. Do we have to, no, we don't have to adjourn the tri board, do we?
No, we don't.
Okay. Thanks for coming.
Welcome. Thank you. Go home.
I'll be
thinking
around.
Of you.
Yeah, all are welcome.
Okay.
Okay, so for the regular select board agenda, then we'll go right into our consent agenda. For our consent agenda this evening, we have two accounts payable warrants, 1733 and 34.
So,
hang on there.
All right.
We have an indirect cost agreement with the Hadley Public Schools. We have police appointments, and I believe we have folks here for that. Can we pull that out as a separate?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. We have a 61A request, and it's a right of first refusal, and a request that the select board waive the 120-day requirement, and that is being made by Mr. Donald Dion. And we also have a request for a one-day liquor license by Wine and Canvas on February 18th and the 25th. Do I have a motion for these?
So moved.
Is there a second?
There's a second. I'd like to bring something up.
Though. Go ahead.
I can't pull up here the warrant articles. I mean the minutes, or the minutes has been taken off.
The minutes have been taken off.
I'm sorry. That's what my question was on the minutes.
No, that's okay. Okay, but no questions on the Dion agreement, Wine and Canvas, direct cost, any of that stuff?
Nope.
Okay, motion made and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Thank you. Okay, and so we do have some folks from our Hadley Police Department here this evening. Chief, would that be you, or would it be Sergeant Cook?
I'll do
you do it? Okay.
Got the whole 18 there tonight.
Okay. Is Hadley's finest?
Another sergeant
coming in the room.
Got the brass here tonight. Right up front here.
Yeah.
My thing on my fence there. I wrote it down for Sam.
Good evening, everybody.
Good evening,
Chief.
Good evening, everyone. As everybody knows, we've been trying to replenish our part-time dispatch and our special police officer ranks because we've promoted folks recently. So we've been working through a hiring process and just completed the most recent one. And we have three part-time recommendations before you. One for dispatcher and two for special police officers. Shall I do all three?
Sure, your pleasure.
Okay. So first finalist for dispatch is Megan Cahill. Ms. Cahill resides in Holyoke, and she is the principal clerk for the building department in the city of Northampton. She previously served as a full-time dispatcher for Northampton Public Safety Department. She is fully dispatch certified already through E911 and holds all of the certifications necessary to start training immediately. She comes highly recommended by her current and past employers. And notably, we learned that through her background investigation that Ms. Cahill was working the night that Anthony Bay set 15 fires in Northampton. Her performance on that night was described as extraordinary. Next, we have for Special Police Officer, we have Joel Coupion. Mr. Coupion currently resides in Enfield and is a patrol officer for the Greenfield Community College Police Department. Mr. Coupion began his career in law enforcement as a full-time police officer for the city of San Diego, California. From there, he began working towards moving back to this area, working as a deputy sheriff in Cumberland County, Maine. Mr. Coupion then worked as a police officer for STCC and was an investigator for the Massachusetts Attorney General's office. He left the AG's office to return to uniform policing. His law enforcement certifications from California are accepted in Massachusetts, and he is a certified background and sexual assault investigator, and he's an instructor for the MPTC in subject areas of drug identification, report writing, and is also a legal update instructor. And finally, we have Daniel Phillips. Mr. Phillips is a resident of Goshen and is currently a part-time police officer in Dalton. where he has worked since July of 2016. He also currently works for Stop and Shop as a loss prevention officer, where he has worked since 2010. Mr. Phillips is also a veteran of the United States Army and served from 2003 to 2006 as an infantryman, and is a recipient of, among others, the Army Commendation Medal, Combat Infantry Badge, and Purple Heart. Mr. Phillips has expressed his intentions to leave his full-time employment in order to dedicate himself to police work and our department's field training program. With all that said, I would request that the board, as with all other newly appointed employees, that you accept these recommendations and issue a conditional offer of employment pending psychological evaluation and completion of the training program.
I think we just hit the jackpot. Boy, this is great.
Pretty impressive resume.
It certainly is.
Talk about bench strength.
Certainly.
Very nice.
Madam Chair, I make a recommendation to accept all four members.
Is there a second?
I'll second that.
Okay. Any questions?
Yes. What is a legal update
specialist
instructor?
Every year, police officers are required to do in-service training, and legal updates is one of the topics. Like new laws in Massachusetts, court cases, case law, stuff like that. So I'm certified to teach that.
Good. Okay. Anything else for appointees? If not, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Welcome to Hadley.
Thank you.
I wish we had full-time
permission
for all of you.
Welcome. Thank you very much. You can arrange that.
Can you arrange that?
Yeah.
Always good.
Thank you, sir.
Congratulations. Nice to have you. Congratulations. Thank you for coming to Hadley.
I'll meet you all outside. Thank you, Chief.
Thank
you, as always.
Thanks. Thank you, guys.
A few minutes available if there's anyone here for public comment. That does not include you.
Can I make a public comment?
Absolutely.
I would like to commend the DPW publicly. Over the last two snowstorms when we got absolutely hammered, those guys were out there all day and all night, and they helped us. I know a lot of people saw the Facebook page. I wanted to put a post on there because I thought it was important. Mm-hmm. They helped us get to a lot of calls that we never would have gotten to, even with all-wheel drive vehicles. So they did a great job, and they deserve some kudos.
Absolutely. Thank you. Thank you for pointing that out.
I heard Marla, you even did it for somebody for an ambulance.
Yeah.
I think we had two of those in the last week.
Wow. Yeah. Fabulous. Great crew.
Would you say, Joyce, you want to cut the police budget to increase the DPW budget?
She knows where $5,000 is.
That's right, she's got $5,000.
I'd like to split that $5,000 between the two would be great. Yeah.
The public comment time, since I'm by myself here, would that be a good time to talk about the actual snow and ice budget?
Brief.
It hasn't started. Well, I just wanted to...
Just update?
Yeah,
an
update.
Okay.
This way?
Okay.
Yes.
Let's close the public comment and go on so that we can get this over. You don't have to reopen in case.
Oh, no, we're running. It's almost 7:15, so we're good. Yeah.
Could I make one comment in the public thing, you know, about people? And I know the highway department has done a wonderful job during a storm, but there's still a lot of hydrants out there that aren't cleaned out. And if anybody has one in front of their house, take 10 or 15 minutes, go over there and help the highway department out and the fire department. You know, clean those hydrants out, because if there's a catastrophic fire, 2-3 minutes cleaning a hydrant out to get to the water is very crucial. So if you've got the time, clear out the hydrants near your house. We'd appreciate it.
Yep.
It's the cheapest fire insurance you can buy.
Exactly right.
Well, you know, you're not just taking care of yourself, you're taking care of your neighbors and everybody else, so it does help. And I had my shovel going. But
so if you do a drive-by, Donald, we're good. We're good on Hadley Place.
And we're good over on my end of Bay Road. Yeah.
Well, I think it's good to note that we've got the equipment basically in the staff split in half since the storm ended. kind of taking care of fire hydrants and taking care of the congested areas that people can't get in their driveways, little cubby hole dead ends and stuff like that. So we are chipping away. I mean, that's what we're doing day in and day out right now until we get it done. So.
So at 7:15, we had it on the agenda just to talk about the Bay Road. So do you want to do that, and then we can go into the snow and ice?
Bay Road first, sure.
Just because, believe it or not, sometimes people like look at the agenda, and if they're interested, they actually turn on their TV right now. So okay. Hard to imagine, but it happens.
So we want to do Bay Road.
Bay Road Bridge Design first.
Okay. Yeah. Well, last Wednesday, I had a meeting with MassDOT at the Bay Road Bridge. A team of engineers and construction people came up from Boston.
It was almost 25 out there, wasn't it?
I would say 20. So their intent of coming from Boston is to take a look. And I want to say that this is for the bridge replacement, not the bridge repair coming up in the spring. This is for 2020, the start of it. They came out to talk about the bridge design and the ideas and the information they had to get a bird's eye view of what they were working with to get the design going. So I'll give you a little input on what they said the bridge is going to look like until they finish the design. They want to keep it in the same footprint. The area is classified as urban, and under their standards, it would require two sidewalks, one on both sides of the bridge, upstream, downstream.
But that's up for negotiation.
Yes, and I just wanted to lay out
okay.
What they were talking about. There's potential of them raising the, I guess we call it the south side, the Lawrence Plain Road side of the bridge, raising, elevating that so you don't have quite the steep approach and onto the bridge. Obviously they can't raise the other end a whole lot because of the water plants there, but those were basically the highlights. They said that it was going to have 12 foot lanes. The new bridge is going to be approximately 6 feet wider, so you're talking 12 foot lanes and 3 foot edges, I guess, edge lines you could call it. It's not going to be designed wide enough for a bike lane, is how I understand it.
What if we, instead of having the raised walkway that we have there now, what if we kept that on street level?
That falls into, well, they're going to go with 8-inch curb. They can't go any less than 8 to 12 inch due to, you got traffic coming across there, it needs to protect if somebody's walking on that walkway. As far as the elevation, you have to have some elevation there to protect a pedestrian walking across. If somebody bumped the curb, they can't jump the curb, it wouldn't come over the curb, so to speak. So. It was also talked about, they want to hang the new water main. We had talked about the water main being so old underneath. It's an old 8-inch. And I had discussed with them about the 12, upgrading at the 12-inch. If you look at our water master plan, in the next 10 to 15 years, they are suggesting in the master plan that we upgrade the 8-inch old cast iron on Bay Road, and we already have 12-inch AC on Lawrence Plain Road. So. I talked to them about upgrading that to 12-inch when they put the new bridge, and they might as well put the 12-inch in. So then the discussion came up on that end of things, as far as they said that we can replace in kind. We'll replace the 8-inch because we're tearing the bridge out free of charge, so to speak. And then they said the 12-inch the town may be responsible for.
What's the difference?
There's no cost at this point. This is just in the discussion what we need to decide to do.
Well, no cost figured or no cost difference?
No cost figured. There is a cost. Yes, there is a cost difference.
What's the difference between a 12 and an 8 line? Cost difference. Is it a third?
It's so much per foot. Well, yeah.
Okay,
say
that's my question.
Yeah.
Okay.
You know, the hangers are bigger, how they need to hold that, and heavier water main in the whole line, and there's a lot that goes into it. But I was in discussion with the bridge engineer at District 2 today, and I discussed with him the proposition of why do we have to pay for a whole 12-inch if you're going to do the 8 for free by taking the bridge down? Will MassDOT pick up what the cost of an 8-inch is, and we'll pick up the difference to the 12-inch? So no answer on that because it's so early in the design phase and everything, but I am working on that. It was also asked of us if we would like more street lighting in the area. I think I saw one light off the end of each bridge. It's an option for us. We don't have to decide on that right now. I mean, we would have to pick up the cost on it if they added street lights in the area.
Install or monthly?
However we pay the streetlights.
No, I mean, would we have to pay for the install on the light, or would we have to just pay the monthly fee?
I think it was just monthly fee, but I can find that out. So then, let's see, streetlights, water main, and the biggest part of the discussion was the sidewalks. Would like to go back to that. On the downstream side of the bridge, it drops straight off. There'd be conservation issues. There could be potential land taking if we were to have a sidewalk on the downstream side. I don't see the town of Hadley ever attaching to that bridge sidewalk on that side of the road. If someday we decide to run a walkway from, say, Middle Street to the bridge or beyond, it would make sense to attach on the upstream side where the sidewalk exists now. Because everything is flat there, there's no conservation issues as far as filling areas and land taking.
And there's not one there now.
The bridge would look like the existing one.
There's not a walkway on the downside bridge.
No. Correct. No.
So it wouldn't be one. There's not one there. There wouldn't be
right. Under their design, they want the town of Hadley's blessing to only put one walk on the upstream side.
You said it was going to be 6 feet wider, right?
Correct.
Okay.
Overall.
Can we put a berm there and then have a walkway that's at street level? Could we put a berm? If we're going to be wider, we're only going to have one sidewalk, and it's going to be 6 feet wider than it would have been normally. Can we take and put an 8-inch berm there and then have a street level bike path or bike lane there?
Instead of a sidewalk,
it would be the sidewalk. You told me that the berm's there, and that makes perfect sense to me. If a car veers to your side, it's going to hit the berm. So you're going to add an 8-inch berm, whatever it needs to be there. Next to the 8-inch berm, can we have the sidewalk at street level?
Why, Jerry?
I think that a lot of people use that bridge for various recreational uses.
Snowmobiling.
You might say that.
Possible, like they did with the Coolidge Bridge, to put like a cantilevering sidewalk off the bridge, and then you still gain road space?
I think we have the space, because we're still going to use the 3 inches there. We're 6 feet wider. I'm just talking about putting that 8-inch berm, add an 8-inch berm, and then have the at street level.
So you want it segregated
exactly,
a little bit.
Exactly. The safety issue I never thought of before. And a bridge, the 8-inch berm makes perfect sense to me. I never thought of it. But now if we could still and have access there, the only way to get from one end of town to the other at this point in time is across that bridge.
It's also a pretty heavily area for bike traffic.
It is.
Yes.
I think there's got to be a way we have to address that.
National, what's the road?
Scenic byway.
Scenic byway.
Yes. Yes.
You know, so.
Just while we're talking about it, I don't know. I wanted to take everybody's interest in mind.
So I think everybody's comfortable with the idea of just the one side.
Correct. I absolutely
And that's just a question of how no, best to utilize
no,
that road.
No, both sides.
Right, not on both sides.
Yes, on both sides. For
John?
Fishing purposes.
Well, not
along
a sidewalk.
Along your recreation line.
Yeah, but does it have to be a sidewalk?
Why not?
Because we can
safety
take
purposes
better.
On one side or the other, and they both could fish up on both sides.
The
of the
fish
bridge.
Are only on the left side of
yeah.
the bridge.
Yeah,
they're
okay,
never on the
sure.
Right.
I've fished that my whole life.
They go downstream, so they'll start up there and come on down. You can catch them as they go under.
Well, we know about downstream in this town, that's for sure.
So
they had talked about hanging the. If we go to a 12-inch water main, you would have to hang it from the side of the bridge.
Mm-hmm.
And. It's a historical area. So they had discussed in the meeting we had about camouflaging or covering the water main, so you're not going to have a big, ugly black water pipe hanging off the side of the bridge. So there was discussion there, too,
mm-hmm.
Which I'd like to get out there. So they just wanted a letter from the town of Hadley stating it's okay to go with what's existing there with one walk. The design, Jerry, has not taken place there in the process, but I can definitely put that question out there.
Yeah, they're going to bring the design to us, right?
Yeah. Well, now's the time to talk about it. They had a meeting, there was 25 people there talking about the needs of the bridge, and now they're going to go design it. I don't want to show up with something last minute for them. If we have a chance for
anything. No, I mean, the final design, you're going to bring to the board before they do it, or?
I don't think so. Well, you see the final design? Do you have to sign off on the final design? Do we have to sign off?
I think we do.
Typically, don't they bring 25% to complete plans?
I mean, there's many things they have to deal with the town of Hadley on getting this thing done, so.
That existing water main's underneath the, really underneath the cantilever block now.
Yes.
Sits right now.
Yes. So to answer your question, Jerry, what is it? It's probably about 18 inches, 24 inches from the roadway to the elevation of that sidewalk now. I think that's going to drop to about 8 inches when they're done. I don't think there'll be a separation.
You know what skags cost?
So
if they're going to go through with the 12 inch and you're going to run the insulated pipe all the way, you're actually going to run the insulated pipe beyond where it's at because it's got to drop on both sides.
Yes.
You've already got that in the plan.
Well, I had already said that the one end of the bridge they're going to raise a little bit, John. We're going to gain ground cover on the Lawrence Plain Road side if they adjust the elevation of the bridge on that end, the new bridge.
Yeah, but it's real shallow on both sides there. So.
You know, still in my mind, it's asinine because we got the cost of repairing the bridge. It's like $1.6 million around, I guess, right? And all that's going to be ripped out eventually in 20 for a brand new bridge. So it's just like throwing away $1.6 million in my mind. Well, the state is doing.
I think to address that, if they don't do something with stabilizing the side we're using now, they're going to shut the whole bridge down. I think to stabilize it, I know it's $1.6 million, but we'll lose that bridge until the new one's put in.
There's no way of bringing in a temporary bridge and then construct a new bridge next to it. We don't have land to do it like they did in the Northampton and the Oxbow.
We went through all this at the meeting.
Yeah, and it'll take them just as long to take the land to put the temporary bridge in as it would to replace the bridge.
Yeah. It did come up. They asked if they could close the bridge altogether to replace it, and that was a quick adamant no out of me. You got to keep one way.
Yeah.
And they didn't seem to have a problem with doing it, so.
Well, they started on it, and they were supposed to have been done by now, so.
It's going to be a lot of extra work for them.
Okay, but in the spirit of keeping things moving forward, so you need an answer tonight about whether or not we're going with the one sidewalk. And up until when John came in, we were all in agreement that we were comfortable with the one sidewalk, but wanting to see if there was an opportunity to do something for multiple recreational uses with that 3 feet that's getting added on the.
There was two reasons why I wanted a bike the bridge on both sides.
Yep.
Because if they put a bike lane in, maybe they can connect the bridge sidewalks on both sides to bike lanes.
So you're not doing a bike lane?
Not tomorrow, but how do you know?
Still not wide enough. On the
downstream side, as part of the discussion, there's going to be land taking, there's going to be filling conservation areas with fill. There's a lot of permitting to even attach to the sidewalk if they installed it on the downstream side of this bridge. Mm-hmm. So we talked about all those issues, and again, on the upstream hillside, we already have similar grades of what we need to ever install walkway or bike lane if we had to.
Mm-hmm.
And the land taking portion of it too was discussed on the downstream side.
The state's going to handle all that.
In your discussion with DOT, there's absolutely no way we can get the weight limit amended for an ambulance.
I didn't specifically discuss.
No, but is there a possibility to do that?
I think
we've heard liabilities from our rep. They wouldn't do it because of liability, maybe. But we've never discussed that, I don't think, with them. Just for an ambulance only, nothing else.
When we met with them about a month ago, I think part of the discussion was they described distinctly why the barriers are where they're at and where they're strategically put now.
Mm-hmm.
They didn't specifically say a heavier vehicle, but they specifically said we can't put anything heavier on that bridge. It wasn't exactly.
Well, the ambulance isn't that much heavier.
No, it isn't.
No, I thought Mike had already spoken with them about that.
They did.
It's not only my concern having citizens. Right. We're depriving Belchertown and Granby, adding a half hour to that ambulance run, which is a lot of time.
South Hadley, too.
Yeah, that's also.
Well, we can only ask them again. We can have a, it's not like you got a continual flow of ambulances going across there. It's like.
And just like we told John Seibert the other night, there's still tractor trailers going across that bridge.
Not too often.
And it hasn't fallen in.
Well, but according to the DOT, the discovery has not been good. I mean, every time they look, they're finding more and more things wrong with it, and we run the risk of
shutting
it down.
Yeah.
So I think we need to be careful,
All right, I'm going to make a motion to have one sidewalk.
Okay, is there a second on that motion?
You want to do all these at once, or you want to do them individually?
We have to vote on all of them? Because nothing's in the works about the 12-inch main.
Yeah.
Streetlights are, we said yes on those. You got to have a vote on it?
Marla, we do need
for
direction from us.
You need to send them a letter, correct?
Tonight, the most important thing was the one or two sidewalks, the recommendation from the board.
And how about the 12-inch main? Or is that a foregone conclusion? All I want to know is the difference. I think we're willing to pay the difference between the 8 and the 12. I don't want, if it's a 12 and they're not going to pay anything from it, then let's make sure that we need a 12 there.
Well, I think at that point, I'd look at the master plan and say, how long is it going to be before we upgrade the main
anyway.
On either side of that bridge? And where we're at with that. That's a fairly large project on Bay Road. As we know, that's an old cast iron pipe. But
my point is, I'd rather negotiate this out if one side is cheaper to do than two, and we can get the 12-inch main there taken care of, then I'm all for doing that all at once.
Why, they're not going to fund the 12-inch?
They'll fund the 8-inch replacement of their replacement cost.
8-inch.
And we would pay the difference.
We don't know that.
I'm in discussion with them now, John, whether we have to pay for the full bolt 12-inch or the difference between the 8 and 12-inch.
Bring them in front of the board.
Well, you got a motion and a second on the floor regarding the one walkway.
I didn't hear a second.
I seconded it. I'm sorry.
Okay. All right, so motion made and seconded. Any further discussion on the walkway?
And just with Jerry's recommendation about a berm or whatever he asked for.
Yeah, we're seeing what we can do to accommodate.
If it works, if it doesn't,
right.
Fishing, we're doing it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Let's ask.
Yeah, absolutely.
It's probably going to be 8-inch anyway, whatever the berm is.
Yeah, 8-inch.
Okay, so motion made and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
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 Opposed?
No.
All right, so Marla, while you're here, why don't we jump to Route 9 projects?
Rehashing things.
So there are two items here, one of which is the intersection at Mill Valley Road and Route 9. This is something that was brought up as an action item at the last select board meeting. We have some information from the chief of police there. And the other is the no turn on red signs at Route 9 and Route 47 intersection just outside Town Hall.
I thought we already took a vote on that the last time DOT was here. And we told them we wanted a right turn on reds.
No, I don't. Well, we were talking about it. I don't think we voted. What do you mean?
There was a discussion. I don't think there was a
You want to be able to take the right turn
or
have the not turn on red?
No. We want to be able to take the right turn on red.
In which order do you want to take this, Madam
Probably
Chair?
Out of the 7 days a week I go to work at 6 o'clock, probably three or four, I'm the first car sitting there, and it's nice to take the right turn on red.
There's been a request from the Council on Aging that those signs on right turn on red after stop, or no right turn on red, be reinstalled for public safety issues.
Where's the public safety?
And the public safety, I wish the chief was here, because the chief, I believe, was also in favor of having these signs put back.
Yeah.
Well, why don't you put that off until the chief is available?
The way that they fly through that, sometimes through that intersection.
They're blind spots.
They're blind spots, and people take that turn, and here comes something barreling from one direction or the other. And
2/3 of the traffic that sits there can do whatever they need to, then put arrows in.
Right.
Is what I say then.
Because when you're sitting there, the cross traffic can go when it goes. When the traffic is going that way, you ought to be able to come off 47 and take a right on Route 9. There's no possible problem there other than pedestrians walking across, and there's a push button to push. If you push the button and your walk is...
But that's different from not having a no turn on red, what you're talking about?
No, I'm saying
it's the same thing.
No, it's not, because regardless of who has the right of way, if you come rolling up to the main intersection in town, which I believe was one of the hot spots for traffic accidents up until the point in time that they put
the extra lane in.
The extra lane and change the timing of the lights. People just kind of roll through, and then they're moving, and there's there are blind spots in both directions. And again, it's immediately proximate to the Council on Aging, and will continue to be. So you have people, not that I'm saying anything wrong about older drivers, but perhaps they don't have the same response time that they did.
The problem isn't the right turn on reds, it's the left turn on green that the problem is. And I've seen it at that intersection myself.
Well,
it's not the right turn on red after stop.
Let's get the chief in here.
Yeah, why don't we get, because otherwise it just becomes anecdotal and what everybody's buddies want. Right. And I don't want to make a safety decision based on that.
No.
So
I'd say let's have
can we keep this on the agenda for a future point in time? Okay, so.
We should have done it when he was here.
Yeah, I wasn't thinking about it.
What about Mill Valley Road?
It didn't sound like there was data to support the concern based on the information that was sent back to us. Is that right, David? Unless I missed something.
Yeah, so certainly we're engaging with MassDOT to review the situation, particularly as that building becomes crowded with tenants, and I believe they have one already. We're trying to get the building owner to be part of the conversation. So this is a work in progress. Just wanted to let you know that we're looking at various options. But I think everybody recognizes the way that this road joins with Route 9. It creates an unsafe situation if you're moving westward from Mill Valley onto Route 9, because you're craning your neck over your...
You can't see towards Amherst.
Right.
When you're coming out that road, you can't see that way.
And with the new tenant, with the new development on that road, it looks like it's going to be used more often. So the sooner we can jump on this, we can prevent safety issues.
I think the concern is that the people coming down 9 and that are going to make the turn into the driveway there are going to be slowing down and making the turn into the driveway. So the people coming off of Route 9 are going to be going that way. But I
think it's a multitude of concerns.
Yeah, I do too.
And I think one of the assertions that was made was that it was a high incident accident area already. And I think that's the data didn't actually support that.
I wonder what the planning board had to say on that when they agreed to that project, because usually they look at curb cuts and things of that nature when they...
I don't think that issue really came up at that time.
Probably that was on farmland for so long, right?
But no, now, yeah.
That was a piece of property that where a house was, too.
But
there was never any businesses.
There were no businesses, so people, it was just farm country.
I think what needs to be created there is a 90-degree angle, too.
Yeah.
There's a pole in the middle, you got a double, I guess you can call it a double Y or a Y.
Mm-hmm.
When I looked at it, my first thought is, okay, the part would be one way. If you're going west and you're kinking your neck,
no,
stop traffic from going out that way, make it all go right so they're 90 degrees to Route 9. But the problem doing that is tractor trailers or anything with any length, it's a very narrow on the right hand side, they're not gonna be able to take a left hand turn, so that kind of fell by the wayside when I looked at it. I think John and I had talked about it too.
The state's really doing those 90s everywhere.
On any roundabout there.
But now, no.
Hadley's first roundabout.
When Dan Regish brought it up, it's just good to have it in the back of our minds to get planning on it, because if they intend to go to South Maple Street with the Route 9 project, then now's time for them to put the 90 degree in and take care of it, you know, and let the state pay for it, not us.
Yeah, I agree with that.
My guess is you know, that's how they design all intersections today.
Yeah,
you can't put an intersection illegally like that today. So I wouldn't venture to say they're going to address that when they get there.
I don't think the DOT would entertain another light that close.
Well,
to the
I was
other
thinking
one,
that too.
You know?
You
that's
Lowell's
true too. Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
Real close. Seemed like the easiest way to make Mill Valley one way, going east.
Exactly, with two lanes, one for pulling into the parking area, and the rest
and
on the other way.
Eliminate the Route 9 bottleneck.
Yeah. Okay. Well, anything that sounds like a discussion point with DOT at this point.
Yeah. Well, we'll find out what there is for incidences, anyways. And I agree with everybody here that you know the time to change that. It's been like that for a long time since Flaherty's Crossing was there. So.
DOT's already did some of the borings and stuff down Route 9 all the way to South Maple, so they've got to have a preliminary plan. I just want to make sure that they have that in the works now as they're going along, you know?
Yep.
For stage 3 or 4 or wherever that ends up being.
Yep. So, David, you're asking us to review the information. There's nothing in here, but it all came via email?
That's correct. We gave you hard copies of it because there was some communications from the police department. I wasn't clear whether that was for public information or not.
Okay. So go back, take a look at that, and then we'll resurrect this discussion.
I read the accident statistics, and it didn't seem right to me either, like you were saying.
Yeah, hardly anything. Yeah.
I've got a couple of questions with the Route 9 project winding down.
Mm-hmm.
The lines that they've painted, I don't know if those were temporary, but they're almost all completely worn out. So I don't know if we can investigate to see them painted again as part of the project
or not. I think they hurriedly did it before winter fell.
I think so too, but there's no lines left.
They actually got canceled. The line painting company got canceled 3 times trying to get it done before.
I think the last time was the day before a snowstorm, too.
Yeah.
So.
It looks like I think they need to redo it.
And the other thing is I want an update on the Legion parking lot and the town property that they, you know, tore up completely. What would their answer be to remedying it?
The last that I had spoken with ETNL, the contractor on that, is we were going to revisit it in the spring when they come finish the punch list of installing signage and some other work they need to do.
It's fine then, as long as it's on the list.
Oh, it's on the radar.
Okay.
And Donald, when you talk about town property, you're talking about the field?
No, the upper portion where they are and all they put all the gravel and heavy equipment. The town owns the upper portion.
Right,
they're almost on the field
the
now, though.
Yeah, they've gone a little further. You're right.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, so.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Opened up some more parking for them up there.
Well.
Okay, so, Marla.
The top part's probably going to be torn up anyway with the your seniors.
Do you have any reason to be here for the water abatement and sewer abatement conversation or no?
Not unless you have questions for me.
There's one of them, the first one. Let's just do that one.
Okay, so water abatement. First request is for 17 Kennedy Drive. Okay, and we have the correspondence between Sharon at the water department. We've got a copy of the bill. And it was Sharon's assertion here. Let me just open this up. That this was not a metering issue. So looks like the water department went back and reread the meter. The usage appeared to be consistent. There were 2 periods of high usage, but it could be consistent with the fact that it was a severe drought year. So at any rate, sounds like my reading of this is that the water department is not recommending that we offer an abatement in this case.
Correct. Has the meter been tested there?
Yes, I believe.
It was tested.
If we ever get any abatement, we go back and reread it and test it.
Not reread it, tested.
I mean, it was 331, but then in 2016, the same time, it was 268.
It's not that far
it's
off.
Not
it's
that
not,
far
you know,
off.
And we had a dry drive somewhere. I mean, I make a recommendation not to abate that.
I second that recommendation.
Okay, any further discussion on that abatement request? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Abstain.
Okay, and then we have 2 sewer abatements. Both of these abatements are at the request of our town collector, who's indicating that there was a point software issue.
On one, and the other one was they filled the pool and they're looking for the abatement on the sewer, right?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yep.
I recommend we abate both those.
Second.
Any further discussion on those 2 sewer abatements? All in favor?
Aye.
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 Abstain.
Abstain.
Okay. All right, Marlo, I think that is it for anything. So you're
awesome.
Welcome to stay.
Thanks again, and thanks to the guys.
Yeah.
Nice
yes,
job.
John, you missed, before you arrived, the chief of police made a point of wanting to commend the DPW personnel for the fine job that they did. You did.
We tried.
You all did.
We tried.
As much as we would like to send Marlo home so he can get some much-needed sleep, he still needs to talk about the snow and ice budget.
Yeah, I was just, like, hoping not to talk about it. Okay, Marlo.
Well,
keep spending.
Is what it is.
Keep forgetting about that.
Yeah, so we're obliged to report
yes,
to you,
you
that, that the winter has been tough, that the budget has been largely depleted. We've got bills coming in, so we don't have figures to give you some precision, but I think it's safe to say that with another month and a half of winter ahead of us, that we're going to need to deficit spend that account.
And so
we're
be
obliged,
it.
We're obliged to report that.
Nothing you can do about it.
Right, and there's no approval required from us. It's really, again, you're required to notify
yes.
us. Yeah.
I put some rough figures together after regular work hours waiting for the meeting. Did things manually and the best I could find the figures in Vadar, but we're looking at somewhere around $20,000 left in the account after this week's mm-hmm. payroll and snow fighting. And I really don't have a lot of salt in the shed. I think it would behoove us to get a few more loads in there.
Didn't you put in an order Friday or Saturday?
I put an order in earlier in the week, but we had 5 out of 7 days we had storms.
Okay, so you need to do another order?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. I mean, one of those storms, it was like nothing happened the next morning, but we were sliding around in freezing rain all night.
Mm-hmm.
Keep the roads open. We treated 3 times, so
okay.
literally close to 3 storms.
You have to do
one.
What you have to do.
Yeah, we hired you for your judgment, so.
I think you saw my emails 3 or 4 weeks ago. We were looking great, and now all of a sudden, we're up to 17 events, I call it.
Yeah.
So.
No storms for the next 10 days.
Can I hold you to that?
Yeah. And thank you, too, Marlo, for your updates to us. I appreciate that.
Yeah.
I would like to just take a second, and it's my first winter here in Hadley, and I would like to say to the staff that works for me, for us, they're a pretty dedicated bunch. They know what they're doing out there. And I say they're stubborn in the most politest ways. They want black roads.
Mm-hmm.
It was a group effort. We had 2 very large storms in the past week, as we all know. Everybody helped out. Water, sewer, highway, managers. Everybody jumps in. Everybody works together. So I publicly would like to say thank you to the staff.
Thank you.
Yeah, we all appreciate
it. We know what the
it.
Guys went through. How did our equipment come through it? Any major breaks or anything?
We didn't want to hear about the budget, but I will say that equipment is holding up very well.
It's all brand new.
We have a 40-year-old plow that's in dire need of some welding and fixing.
Yeah. Knock on wood.
You know, lights, mirrors, little things here and there. So far, it's been very good. Knock. So.
Not too many mailboxes either.
Yeah.
And we're doing okay.
My husband took them.
Yeah, I was just going to say, not from our DPW, maybe from some residents.
One last thing. The equipment that was voted at the ballot, how are you doing with trying to get that equipment purchased?
Both vehicles have been ordered. We decided on not exactly a skid steer to replace the skid steer. I brought in a piece of equipment called a whacker. It's like a mini loader. I placed an order for one of them. Everyone agreed it would be the cat's meow. We could use it in a lot more places than a skid steer, like a multi-tool, as opposed to the limitations of a skid steer. So we're expecting to see that somewhere the end of February, middle of March. And we're in the process of deciding on a new chipper. We've done our homework. We brought a couple in for demo. So 2 vehicles, skid steer replacements on order. We should be seeing them in the next couple months. And it's just a matter of me doing a purchase order for the chipper, I think.
And I guess the last thing I want is an update on the filters for the water.
The membranes?
Yeah.
Well, the second set got installed a week later because snowstorms. We had to dodge that. They went in without a hitch. The water tested out. Membranes are done. We're up and running.
so.
Not much difference in operations?
They're seeing a very big difference in the vacuum right out of the gate. So we kind of figured, but we're not having to clean as frequently because it's running so much more efficiently. Yeah.
Okay. Is there anything else that anybody wants to ask Marlo Warner? Go so home. Marlo can go home and get some rest. We're good?
We're good.
All right. Thanks, Marlo.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. On old business, we have Fire Substation and Senior Center RFQ finalists, David.
All right. So we had snow and the interviews didn't happen quite yet, so this slide can be deferred.
Okay. All right, so we're going to push this off to a subsequent meeting.
Rescheduled, though.
Yeah.
Ready.
Good night. Town report.
Jen?
David? Jennifer?
We have a request for a dedication. Do you want to send that off to committee?
I thought we already did. I thought we already added to it.
What committee?
The committee.
Yeah, we can do that. Okay. Capital project request.
John Seibeck was in front of you asking for a capital request to put into the budget. Items of about $100,000 are easily funded through the state budget, but you can shoot the works and go for something farther out in your capital plan, such as sludge handling improvements for $852,000.
What's the chance of us getting that passed?
We got it into an environmental bond bill last time, and that died in committee.
It died in committee?
Yeah.
But did it die with laughter?
No. It actually got funded. Okay. It actually got passed, but the governor didn't release the funds for it.
Mm-hmm.
So
let's do it again.
If you want to go for $100,000, you can probably get it in time for the 18 budget. If you want to go for something larger, I would put it to something where we don't have to be in a crisis situation if the funding doesn't come through, but it would be great if it did.
Mm-hmm.
So I recommend a police cruiser if you want to do it quickly.
We just added two cruisers, didn't we? Or are you going to take one off? I think we need to look at the amount of cruisers we have.
Yeah, I wouldn't be inclined to do a cruiser. I mean, I was thinking either in terms of, and the IT, we may have the opportunity for a grant, right?
Right, that's coming up on March 1st, that IT grant. So
right.
We'll be talking about that.
So I'm what about infrastructure? We're always talking about infrastructure.
How about clarifiers? Did we get that on straight now?
Clarifier, we've already raised some money for that.
What about the...
Did we get a second clarifier, or did we just have one?
We had two clarifiers.
They're both going to be
changed. They're both being upgraded.
John, what's yours?
No, they got options on them, which we're supposed to be meeting tomorrow, though.
Yep.
Rather than that sludge handling thing, I didn't really think that we should be concentrating on the influent part of that plant.
I'm sorry, what part of the
effluent?
The influent part.
Influent
of the plant. Now that we've updated station one, the flow is up a little bit. At high peak periods, and the influent channel that was built, I don't know what order that was in the capital plan. I was looking at it today again, but we can bring that up tomorrow at that meeting maybe.
Okay, so.
And that was up about the same price as that sludge handling.
So there was the aeration tank flow splitter.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that is for $153,000.
No, that's combined with the influent channels. So it's up around 800. It's about the same amount of money.
I don't see the influent on here. Unless
it's
I'm just
in,
not.
It's in the capital plan.
I'm looking at the capital
plan. This is the capital plan.
There. Are you talking about the sludge handling improvements?
No, you were talking about the sludge handling improvements. I was talking about where is it?
There's septage receiving improvements for $260,000.
Yes, the septage, influent, and what was the other one you just said? See, you got it broke down here. But in the actual... septage receiving it's not even.
So, what are we looking for? What's sexy for the legislature? It's public safety and it's clean water.
Right.
You know, these are the things that they like to fund.
Yeah.
So that's why I say either talking about a police cruiser for funding immediately, or we're talking about a larger capital project in the wastewater treatment plant.
Yeah, and I'm thinking that, you know, the town's been very generous fairly recently with some of the Department of Public Work projects,
yeah.
And there are oh so many more to come.
Mm-hmm.
And I think to the extent we can offload some of these things that may not be quite as obvious and meaningful to the voters.
That's just a portion of that.
I'd like to see some the wastewater stuff.
Okay.
I mean,
how about the computers? I mean, we're talking about that being one of the IT being a huge thing that's going to benefit all the different departments within the community.
But they have grant funding available for that.
Yeah.
But we don't have it. I mean, I hear you, but another grant funding falling by the wayside while we have an opportunity here for $100,000.
I'll ask for whatever you want.
No, I'm just saying, what's the number for that?
I don't want you to ask for something that they're going to turn around and say you got a grant for, and therefore you don't get anything. So I'm just saying your best chance is public safety, environment.
I mean, doesn't...
I'm sort of inclined to agree with you, Madam Chair, wastewater something, because the DPW graciously put off their building for us so we could accommodate other buildings. And if we can do anything in infrastructure, I think it would be a home run.
Yeah, I think it's infrastructure. It has a better chance of success, and we don't have other funding mechanisms available. I'm totally in lockstep with Jerry that we need to do everything we can to get grant, you know, anything to support improving the IT, because that will have a marked immediate improvement on our quality of work.
Is there any way we could apply for funding for the future water or sewer lines going east on Route 9 that we're going to have to replace eventually?
Yeah, well, that's like $1,250,000.
Yeah, that's a lot.
That's a lot.
And a lot of that isn't actually going to be replacement. It's, you know, a lot of it could probably be sleeve lined.
Mm-hmm.
But the sleeve lining that they have today, you know, isn't the same as we were looking at in 2008 when we went through the capital plan for the wastewater. So where we thought that we needed to replace some sections, which you still might need to replace a section here or there,
mm-hmm.
but you could sleeve line it rather than replacing.
So my recommendation would be for David to work with Marlo to come up with a combination of some of these infrastructure items in the DPW wastewater,
right.
And ask for that.
Okay.
That's just my two cents.
Yeah, no, I'm with you.
Yeah.
You're right.
Like I said, these were
all...
You
want a motion for that?
In the 2008 capital plan, these were all... individual, so if there was something at the time that mm-hmm. failed that we could take out of the budget, that's why it was itemized
yeah.
that way. But
we can bundle them for this purpose.
That's what I'm saying. The next project, because of the upgrade of the station number one that handles all the flow to the plant,
mm-hmm.
this would
be the inflow.
Actually be the next part that needs to be upgraded at the plant.
I'll make a motion to have David and Marlo look into a combination, whatever they have to do to come up with a grant proposal.
Money.
Request.
Request.
Yeah, from the state.
I'll second that.
Yep. Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Abstain.
All right, thank you. We'll take care of that, and we'll get that request to John in time for him to submit it to his chair.
Okay. Next item is the dissolution of the North Hadley Village Ad Hoc Committee. Because this is just getting rid of the Ad Hoc Committee to dispose of it, but we have a new building committee up and running.
Correct.
Second.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
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 Annual town meeting warrant. David, you're looking for a vote to close the warrant?
That's right. We're scheduled to close the warrant tonight.
I'll make a motion to close the warrant tonight.
Okay, second on the motion for discussion?
Second for discussion.
Okay, I believe at the beginning of the meeting, Donald was talking about the possibility, depending on where things go, would like to keep the option open.
There was a place parallel before, wasn't there?
For what?
For the possibility of an override.
Possibility, right. So in Article number 6, the omnibus budget, the override would be the form of the motion for that article.
That's fine.
That's good.
Okay.
So it's there.
Okay.
If you need it.
And again, to Jerry's point, if anything comes up in the past, if there's an emergency or something that couldn't have been contemplated now, we've reopened the warrant and then closed it.
Could I ask that we hold two placeholders for the Municipal Building Committee? They asked if we could have two placeholders for them as well.
Sure. They're already in there, aren't they?
They weren't in the first one, but again, I didn't get a chance to look at the second one.
But what are the placeholders for?
That's what they'll tell you.
Yeah, but we were
want placeholders. Nah, let's skate with it. They're asking for two, just like we did for the
planning board.
For the planning board, and we do for the
I'm in.
Yeah, I mean, we can pass all.
They're asking for them. Let's just
CPA committee.
Yeah, CPA, exactly.
All right.
I mean, if they don't use it, they don't use
Let's
it.
Let's just be consistent with how we treat people.
I know. It's just also the last time that we had how many placeholders for them? Like five? So and then we were going right up until the 11th hour and trying to figure out what was going in there. So I just want to avoid that this time.
We'll try.
Yeah.
We'll try. We'll try. Okay.
Okay. You okay with that, David?
Yep.
Okay.
What was the other one we were talking about, David, that you said was that you added to here?
I was we were talking about the $500
for $500 Christmas charities. Yeah, yeah. That's in here.
Can somebody tell me what this petition is for?
This is a non-binding petition that has to do with the desire to remove the undue influence of political contributions to campaigns and political activities.
But what does that boil down to? What? What
it's
do they
know? It's a resolution. It's an expression of
It would be the will of town meeting to send a message to the Commonwealth saying that we don't like it.
It's a petition article, which was done correctly. I think we should honor it.
Yeah, I was just wondering what it was. I didn't understand it. That's all. Okay.
It's sort of like before when the colleges voted no investments in oil in foreign countries.
Right.
Sort of the same.
Exactly.
It's giving them a forum to express themselves, in other words.
Okay.
One other question I got before we get to adjournment is preparation for the town report. Who's responsible? Is that going to be Jennifer's?
Yeah.
It's all falling with her and pulling it together?
Yep. I did it last year, the second day I started.
Oh, good. You know, if you need help, I'd like to volunteer and help you with that. You know, try to put some life into it for the contest at MMA.
Put some life?
Put some life into it. Make it look a little bit more presentable or whatever we have to do.
Yeah.
You know, to compete in that contest.
She has feelings, you know.
Well, I also would like to state that last year I came in and did it, literally started my second day here, and I did somebody else's work. I've actually contacted a couple of local photographers. I actually have some ideas for it.
Great.
And I was planning on submitting next year anyway. I talked to David about it. Mm-hmm. And I will say that while putting pictures and such in it is such a great idea, it costs a lot of money to put color pictures in, and gray and white just don't really translate so well.
Yeah. Front and the back's what wins you the money.
I've got a brand new shiny fire truck for the back. And a very nice picture for the front.
I think the last time we won a award when we put the sailing ship Yankee on the front.
No.
Irving Johnson, wasn't it?
No. We won
after that?
A couple years ago.
Which one would that be?
I think for 2 years in a row we won it.
I will do my best for the town of
Hadley. I'm sure you will, too.
Oh, I know. I'm not complaining.
Okay.
Believe me, you know. It's
But I think you're also asking, though, if there's a draft available or whatever.
Yeah, something, you know, to show the board and as you go along and how it's pulling together.
Absolutely.
And make sure everybody's giving you their reports in a timely fashion.
Yeah, I would be curious about that. How are you doing?
They were due today.
Yeah.
I have, without naming names, because I'm going to call them tomorrow and talk to them about it, I have about seven boards, committees, departments that have not submitted their reports. And I would say for everybody listening, DPW got theirs in and he's been very, very, very busy. So if you could get yours in, I would appreciate it very much. But they have to go to the printer. It has to go to the printer within the next 2 weeks.
Okay. But do you need any help in that regard in getting people to contribute?
Not yet. I'm doing the NICE still.
No, just saying we're here to serve.
I was going to do a gentle
we're
reminder.
We're all liaisons.
And then I will reach out to where I need to and let y'all do it.
Okay.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
So. Sorry, I lost track here. Did we take a vote to close the warrant?
No, we did not.
I did.
There was a motion made.
And a second.
And a second made. Do you have a motion made and seconded, Jennifer?
I do.
Okay, all in favor?
We added the two placeholders.
Yep. Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
So we'll refer the warrant to the appropriate committees, Jerry, to the Capital Committee, for the Finance Committee, CPA, and any other committee that needs to work on this, and we'll be talking about it at your next meeting.
Excellent.
All right.
Okay, so we next on the agenda, we have the Senior Center's request for service, yes.
Yeah,
Geotech and then phase one. Good.
So these, we can bundle the fire substation and the Senior Center together. It's basically the same request for services for geotechnical analysis of the soil structure on which these proposed buildings are going to be situated. And the other one is just a soil analysis to make sure that we don't have any contaminants in the soil.
Mm-hmm.
So in the spirit of bringing major decisions back to the board so that you have control over these two projects, I'm asking permission to release these requests for services.
So moved.
Second.
Okay, motion made and seconded. Any discussion?
Are we doing both 7-8 and 7-7?
Yes.
Yep.
We'll do them bundled.
Yeah.
Okay, if not, all in
can
favor?
They, David, do you know if they can use any of the borings they did for the library? Was any of those borings within the...
The borings that we're talking about for the new Senior Center would be away from where those other borings were.
Yeah, they didn't go that far out in the field.
No, they didn't.
It's a good question, though.
Yeah. Okay. Motion made and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. And then, David, we also have your report. So is there anything on your weekly report you'd like to highlight that we have not already discussed in this
meeting? So all budget all the time, all annual town meeting warrant all the time, all annual report for the town report all the time. So that's basically what we've been working on. There's a number of projects that we've been moving forward. Senior Center, the fire substation, Bay Road Bridge. We've also developed a scope of work for the feasibility study for the shared finance director with the town of South Hadley, which is being funded through a grant. We're preparing for the IT grant for next week. So that's basically where we are right now.
I see our grant in the paper was listed for $1.3 million with Belchertown.
Yes. This is a community development block grant. This would be providing much needed home improvements for the elderly and those in need in Hadley. We hope that we're as successful with that grant. We can do a lot of good work with it.
Can we talk for a second about the IT grant that we're looking for the 1st of March?
Yeah.
How are we applying for that? Through what?
We would be applying through the Department of Revenue, through the Governor's Office for the IT grant. It's part of his Commonwealth Compact. So
remember that extra?
Since it was his recommendation,
yeah.
Mm-hmm. It was the Governor's recommendation based on what was submitted to us.
Right.
Do we feel that we...
I guess
the way you talked me out of so fast that we're going to apply for that grant, do you feel that we're going to be successful with that grant? Do you have an inner feeling that we should know about?
Yes, I think that we're in really good shape for that grant, particularly since we do have the 5-year strategic IT plan already in development. We're not just saying, well, we need a computer here, we need a computer here. We've got a plan, and the grant would go specifically to the scope of work contained within that 5-year plan. So I think, given the early conversations that we've had with Sean Cronin and others at the Department of Revenue, given the fact that we're well positioned for this strategic plan, I think we have an excellent shot at this grant.
And what would we get? And what would we do with the money?
We would get about $25,000, I'm thinking. That's a guess on my part.
We can ask for more, correct?
I believe you can.
I think we ask. I mean, if you go back to that Northeast IT consulting report.
Right. We need about $60,000 to finish that whole five-year plan.
And that's just what was in there, let alone the things that they didn't
scope out. You know, you probably could even expand a little bit on that. You've got the SCADA system for the wastewater.
Yeah,
the water's already on it. But, you know, a portion of that could be used right there.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, I think we throw in everything but the kitchen sink, because many of the grants that were rewarded, according to the lieutenant governor, they last for X, but they got X minus.
So if you're looking at, roughly, if you're looking at 60, and I don't know, what was that SCADA amount in?
It was like 100.
Yeah.
So my point is that it's hard to add down the road, because, you know, 2 or 3 years down the road, everything that we've got funded today is now going to be obsolete, and we won't be able to upgrade. Mm-hmm. You know, it seems to me that our whole program that we could get together, if we can upgrade everything at the same time, mm-hmm. Would make a whole hell of a lot of sense to me, if we can.
Yeah.
So I'm glad to hear you're optimistic regarding that. I'm glad it was a recommendation that was given to us, you know, that by the state already. So, I mean...
Yeah, and you were going to reach out to Northeast IT Consulting for assistance with the grant?
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah. Yep. Okay.
Because the water just updated their SCADA too, didn't they?
Yes, yep. They did.
Yep. All right. The parking lot, was that in... Remember we were going to look for some money for the parking lot? Was that going to be done as a warrant article?
All right, so going back to those two articles, yes, the $25,000 for the parking lot, this is for the town hall.
Correct.
Is included in the warrant. You'll, and,
excellent, okay.
And just bear in mind that we have two articles from long ago with $140,000 that we could use for a funding source for that parking lot. I would recommend that, unless there's a compelling reason to deploy that money elsewhere, that's where we go. And if that's the way we go, then we don't even need an article for it.
This is just food for thought, and I don't know, it's opening up a can of worms in a way, but eventually we're going to have to deal with North Hadley Hall again.
Yes.
So, not now, but maybe eventually we could appoint an ad hoc committee to study all avenues that possibly the building could be used for and report back to us in a timely fashion. If they don't find any, then we have an answer.
We have town meeting's recommendation to sell it, correct?
Yeah.
Yeah. So does that supersede getting a,
you know? Hand up.
So what I would recommend is that we actually have done this work twice. We did it with the old Mohawk Historic Preservation Plan. So there's a recommendation to upgrade North Hadley Village Hall based upon the Historic Preservation Plan. We also have the Department of Drummy Racine Anderson report about the seven buildings, one of which was North Hadley Village Hall. So they've also taken a look at North Hadley Village Hall and talked about the potential and the costs for upgrades there. So I would start there, review that information, and then you can give your subcommittee more focus, because we've done a lot of this work already.
Well, and I think, I don't want to put words in your mouth, but I think part of what Donald might be getting at is we all know that a fair amount of time has elapsed from when this first came in front of town meeting until now, and the North Hadley substation wasn't in the mix, now it clearly is, and for lack of a better way to put it, a lot of people weren't necessarily aware of what was going on, so I think there's a fair amount of energy that I certainly hear around North Hadley Hall of people saying, did you think of this? Did you think of this? Did you think of this? Why can't we do over 55 housing? Is anybody interested in that? So whether it's an ad hoc committee another public forum for people who are interested in understanding where we're at. Not now, I think to your point down the road once we, because where it's been left now is we agreed to hold off on doing anything until we get through the substation. But maybe as we're approaching the end of that, it would be worthwhile.
Are we going to have a ballot for special, for annual town meeting, of course?
For capital articles on the annual town meeting warrant.
Okay, because I was just going to bring up the same thing I brought up the last couple of years. Put a non-binding question on the ballot. If people feel the same way about North Hadley Hall as they did when they voted, and use that as a guide.
But I think the point that Donald's bringing up is you want to have good information and have it fully vetted before you just throw it in front of them. Because honestly, I mean, we did that in good faith years ago to say, do you want to sell it or not? And it was like, yeah. But it hadn't been fully thought through, so.
The biggest thing that's coming to me is the Historical Commission. They're really in a push saying, we never were given ample time to see if we could do something with the bill. They did. But they're very...
They're volunteers, just
you know,
like
what
did you say about can of worms?
Sorry, but, you know, but I guess they want a second shot at it or something.
You're
I don't know.
Joyce tonight.
Oh, yay.
Where's
the nitro, Joyce?
To having a small
eventually.
Group pull it all together and put it in a box.
Sorry.
So does anybody else have, so Donald's just throwing that out there. I'm saying I'm not opposed to it, to have future discussions.
I'm not making any proposals
for
anything.
I'm
going to
promise you this, Donald.
I think when the building's up and the truck's back, then we can
discuss
it.
Support you with an override to do anything for that North Hadley Hall.
Oh, no, I'm not going there, believe me.
Good.
Okay. How about an override to tear it down? You might support that.
Yes, I would. You got that one right.
Okay, so then that's the end of our regular agenda. Do we have any announcements this evening?
I have three this evening. We have the passing of Anthony Cardaropoli. He was the grandson of John and Marilyn Waskevich. Condolences to his family. We have the passing of Juliana Nabala of Nabala Farms. So we have our condolences to all of her children and family and grandchildren. And then we have the passing of Joyce Belden, who was Sarah Weinzick's mother and grandmother to Diana and Michael that live in town here. So condolences to them and their families.
Don't we have any new birds? You're always giving deaths.
Well,
how about new birds?
Well, condolences are nice. And birds, well, you heard kindergarten's down, so no, probably not too many birds right now.
Donald, you're in an awfully good mood tonight.
I don't know. Must be the coffee.
Are you on Prozac now?
No.
I had to ask.
Motion to adjourn.
Okay, so I think that concludes motion to adjourn. Motion seconded.
John.
We all should be.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Night, everybody.